much. I'm really excited to have Councilmember Herbold here with us. She has been a resident of Highland Park for 15 years. She's a council member for District 1, that's where we are right now, and represents the neighborhoods of West Seattle and South Park, and has worked on issues of access, fairness, and commitment to shared quality of life. She's helped to craft and pass public policy, which includes paid sick leave for about 190,000 Seattle workers who didn't have it, rental housing inspection program for 250,000 renter households, and an acquainted criminal justice diversion program. And I will just say, I got to meet with Councilmember Herbold in the first week, I think you were in council, and to talk about issues relevant to the LGBTQ community, as well as issues relevant to the park. And I just want to thank you again for kicking off 2017, talking about neighborhood issues. And like I said, we're going to have the council members speak for about 30 minutes, and we'll do some Q&A.
All right. So maybe it may not be a full 30 minutes, but that'll just allow for more time for Q&A.
Yep.
But it may be. I haven't timed my remarks. Thank you all for having me come out and address you. It is a fantastic way to start the new year. I also appreciate the presentation of the sponsoring organizations as well. And can just put a shout out for the Corner Bar, as somebody who attends occasionally. If you haven't gone, it's a whole lot of fun. It's actually, I think, probably the best nightlife on the peninsula the first Friday of the aesthetic action on promoting the creation of a task force on South Park public safety. It would be, the idea is to model the approach that was used in the ID when a task force was created to pull the community together to look at specific strategies that can improve public safety, whether or not they're actually policing strategies, or they might be changes to the physical environment to improve safety, or they might be programmatic changes in making sure that, for instance, youth are engaged in positive activities in the community. And then finally, the T5 Terminal 5 Quiet Zone. This is another, what was called a Statement of Legislative Intent. We directed SDOT to work with Port and Federal Railway Administration to extend the Quiet Zone from Terminal 5 to the Delridge Way, West Marginal Way intersection. This is something that's been requested by members of the communities impacted by the Terminal 5 proposed expansion to address the anticipated noise and vibrations associated with new tenants there. Those are sort of the district-specific items that I focused on, citywide items. The Budget Committee approved my proposal to create a $29 million housing bond intended to expand financing for affordable housing in Seattle. With a vote in favor of this proposal, the Council signaled our shared desire to prioritize housing in the budget process without pitting Seattle's housing needs against other citywide priorities. I also sponsored the creation of what we're calling the Child Care Mitigation Fund to and this definitely, even though it's not specific to District 1, it definitely will help schools in District 1 that are faced with displacement issues. Of the before and after care programs for our school children in K-5 elementary schools. The programs are feeling the squeeze, both because of increased enrollment, smaller class sizes, and the city's own pre-K program. And so we're looking at trying to mitigate those space tensions and pressures by assisting the school district in either building out particular rooms in their current facilities or potentially funding portables. Another item I sponsored is the economic development issue. Again, it's a citywide issue, but it certainly is something that can assist businesses here in West Seattle. It's the Legacy Business Funding Proposal. It's a program that I've been working on over the last year to figure out how to preserve businesses that contribute to the city's unique culture and character that are at risk of being lost. And a legacy business program is a program where a business would voluntarily enter the registry, and in exchange they would receive some additional city services to help address areas where they may have business-related vulnerabilities. You may have heard that the mayor recently announced that the city would not pursue the new proposed $4.7 million bike share program in Seattle to replace the Pronto system, and instead direct the funding to pedestrian and bicycle safety and the Safe Routes to School program. Potential Delridge projects include Highland Park Elementary and Santa Clara Elementary. This will likely come up in the first quarter supplemental budget in a few months on a committee that I sit on. I've mentioned this in the context of the budget discussion because I successfully sponsored a budget action to remove $900,000 in funding for the operation of the Pronto system in 2017 and 2018, and again to preserve that funding for pedestrian safety-related priorities. We also, important issue, we worked on funding new police officers. Throughout 2016, we took a number of actions to fund new police officers, and that we also acted during the budget process as well. The 2016 sort of total number of of new officers that were added, and these are new positions. This is to replace existing police staff who might be either retiring or being out of patrol for other reasons. But we've added 115 new positions, and that's part of a plan to hire a total of 200 officers from 2015 to 2019. These additional officers will help address 911 response times, enhance patrol operations, and do proactive policing. I also sponsored the reestablishment of the pretty popular community service officer program with the Seattle Police Department. Community service officers are unsworn officers who prioritize community services associated with law enforcement, such as crime prevention. And by doing so, they can do more proactive policing, but they can also free up SPD officers for traditional law enforcement activities and respond more proactively to other sort of things that may not rise to the level of crime, but need addressing. The 2018 budget also increases the number of staff to take the 911 calls. They've increased by 13% since 2010. Another item that the council agreed to move forward is to do more enhanced oversight of major capital projects. There are a couple of high-profile budget overruns and a couple of high-profile delays. And because of that, the council agreed during the budget process to revamp how the city tracks and monitors costs and progress to capital projects. As far as priorities for 2017, I'm going to first touch on the citywide priorities, and then I'm going to skip ahead because I think I've got some things out of order here on Delridge-specific priorities. My committee structure, in case folks don't know, is I focus on issues related to civil rights, economic development, Seattle Public Utilities, and the arts. And so I have a responsibility to work on the policy and budget issues related to those issue areas. So that sort of helps me set priorities beyond reacting to things as they come up or sort of just simply focusing only on district issues. So through the committee structure, be focusing on, again, implementing the legacy business program after we get back the work product that was requested during the budget process, or funded during the budget process, working on standing up a public-facing landlord-tenant resource center and putting together a new renters commission, finding ways to use impact fees to pay for issues associated with growth, particularly, again, school facility needs. There's a real, crunch on classroom space throughout the city. Passing police accountability legislation that meets the terms of the 2012 consent decree and the federal government. We have an SPU strategic business plan that we're going to be working on this year. It's a six-year business plan that updates every 3 years. This strategic plan guides SPU in their efforts to keep rates as low as possible while providing services that protect public health and our environment while also meeting regulatory challenges. This document will make some recommendations for rate changes, and there will be some meetings coming up. I encourage you to participate in them because the way I've seen them these meetings be noticed, it's not really clear that this document guides the decisions that the city will make on rates. And so this is real pocketbook stuff. It really affects people's bills. So I really encourage you to get involved in that. We'll look at also what housing projects we can fund with the new $29 million housing bond funds. I'll be working on that. Working on increasing the number of 24/7 shelters that's been identified as a real need, rather than having people have to deal with schlepping their belongings on their back because they get kicked out of the shelter every day at 6 o'clock in the morning. It's been proven to be really helpful to have 24/7 shelters. It also helps with dealing with people's service needs because People are more likely to be able to connect with the case manager to address what some of their wraparound needs are for assistance when they can develop those kinds of relationships in a 24/7 shelter. We'll be monitoring the Office of Labor Standards rollout of the secure scheduling legislation that affects primarily large employers and some regulations for how last-minute changes can be done to people's work schedules. And we'll also be working to address the economic and cultural displacement as well as the displacement in this district that may occur because of the new proposed MHA program, working on trying to figure out how to mitigate that potential displacement of existing affordable housing, and also working with community members throughout the city to strengthen the affordability side of the MHA proposal, and to decrease hopefully the divide between people who are advocating for it and people who are opposing it. And then finally, as a person who has responsibility over civil rights issues, we're going to have a lot to contend with in 2017, preserving our commitment to civil rights in a time of great uncertainty. As far as issues specific to Delridge, I'll be definitely following the efforts for the South Delridge Bus Triangle. I also going to be getting more involved as the Delridge Neighborhood Action Plan is finalized, and it's in draft form right now. I really want to give a shout out to the community, the Delridge, North Delridge Action Community team, for insisting on an approach that supports diverse and engaged communities. The engagement they did was multilingual for the Latino, Somali, Vietnamese, Cambodian communities, and I think it's a model for the rest of the city. Should really be commended for that work. There are a number of community priorities that once the plan is adopted by the council, and that's going to go through the Planning and Land Use and Zoning Committee, which I sit on, I'll be sort of dogging the process, dogging the implementation side to see that the priorities identified in the plan are realized. Those priorities include engaging business and residents to create business support, economic development strategy, creating a multimodal corridor that provides safe transportation connections to community destinations, improving existing zoning that can better serve the needs of the community, improvements to Longfellow Creek, investments in parks and cultural facilities such as the Wetlands and Stewardship Project and the Vietnamese Cultural Association, and addressing the food desert issue. So there's some early implementation of some of these efforts, including the alternatives analysis that ESCOT has done on the Delridge Way multimodal corridor project. I believe they're going to be completing design either in 2017 or early 18. I'll be meeting with ESCOT soon and confirm the timeline on that. And, you know, there's some good early implementation news that the city has no claim on. It's really a testament to the work of the community. The Delridge Grocery Co-op is in its feasibility stage, and it's looking good for entering capital campaign for the tenant improvement to the building. It's really exciting news. And then finally, the Delridge Wetlands and Stewardship Project is raising funds and has just selected a design consultant. I'll also be watching how the Department of Neighborhoods makes recommendations for changes to the Neighborhood Parks and Street Fund using the participatory budgeting process. We know that $285,000 will be available for each of the seven districts in the city for small-scale projects up to $90,000. The first idea is idea collection, which will begin online on January 30th, and the process will conclude with public voting within District 1 in June. I'll be definitely working to inform the community about this on my weekly blog, And, you know, participatory government is a way, participatory budgeting is a way for the community to direct funding for projects that it identifies as high priorities. We've recently learned, unfortunately, that the grant for the roundabout at Holden and Highland Way did not receive the federal funding that SDOT had applied for. They said, SDOT said that the project was well received and evaluated well. They encouraged SDOT to apply again. SDOT has indicated they would try again, and that they are also going to be looking at the state gas tax transportation improvement board grants. And the good news is the city agrees that this is an important project. The construction cost is estimated around $1.2 billion, so that's part of the difficulty in funding it with some of the fund sources that we have internally to the city is the cost of the project. Around $200,000 could advance the design, so I'm considering moving this forward in the supplemental budget process. I talked to Director Kubley today about that, and I've asked for an estimate on what that would cost. And, you know, I think sort of beginning to fund that project will help with the competitive process in future grant applications. Also, I know this community is interested in a rezone over at 16th and Holden to deal with the Dumar site, City Lake property that this community is interested in actually ensuring is used for the development of housing with mixed use retail on the ground floor. The Office of Planning and Community Development has agreed to include the EIS, the Environmental Impact Statement Analysis, as part of the mandatory housing affordability rezone work that they're doing. So they're going to do the analysis that would be necessary to implement those changes as part of the MHA-related rezones. I was asked by Highland Park to look at the Seattle Police Department chase policy in the wake of the tragic events on Highland Park Way. Currently, the policy prohibits chases in instances where if the infraction is a traffic violation, a civil infraction, a misdemeanor, a gross demeanor, a property crime, or the act of eluding alone. Those are the instances in which the police department is not authorized to do high-speed chases. I confirmed that the carjacking in this case involved a deadly weapon, so it didn't fit into those categories because that's not considered, when there's a deadly weapon involved, it's not considered a simple property crime.
Even if it's a few hours after.
I asked that. that was really the focus of my inquiry, is that the chase occurred actually 3 hours after the carjacking occurred. And so I specifically asked whether or not they consider the condition that so much time has elapsed, whether or not they ask or try to determine whether or not it's even the same person driving the car 3 hours later. What I was told is that considerations as to the time elapsed, whether or not the driver was known to the suspect, I'm quoting SPD right now, whether or not the person was presently armed are among those facts that an officer factors into the calculus as to whether, based on the facts and circumstances then present, the need to apprehend an eluding subject outweighs the risk of a particular pursuit. That language is not actually in the policy, though. SPD's position is that the written policy is intended to be a general framework, and they use training to do some of the more nitty-gritty things about like how you make these more nuanced determinations. They said that they would consider adding more specific considerations to the policy itself. And I think it's important because the determination of whether or not a high-speed chase happened in a way that was consistent with policy. It's just that. They look at whether or not it's consistent with policy. And the training is additive, but I think we want some accountability on the policy side. And so that's why I think some of this language needs to be in the policy side, not just on the training side. So they agreed to take a look at this because they are actually in the process of revising their a number of their policies, including the case policy. Told me that also, as their training evolves, it's informed by experience, they'll ensure that circumstances such as those presented here are among those considered for discussion in that context in the next round of curriculum development. And then finally, I asked them about the technology that's available to track a suspect in a case like this. There's something called STAR Chase technology. And basically, they are able to put a tracker on a car. When they looked at this several years ago, is that a tracker can be a potentially useful tool. It's not effective in rainy conditions, which of course we have a lot of. It doesn't stick well to wet metal. And so that in order to be deployed, the officer would still need to be in such a close proximity to the fleeing vehicle that it would still require some measure of pursuit driving. They did acknowledge, though, that it's been several years since they looked closely at this technology, and we all know how quickly technology changes and evolves and adapts to current needs. And they're going to take another look. And they're also looking into a lot of vehicles have OnStar technology that can be disabled. So they're looking into whether or not there is that the police department can purchase to basically disable. It would only work in the cases of cars that have this OnStar technology, though. Other things that are maybe a little bit more specific on a particular policy topic that the council is going to be working on a lot in 2017 relates to the mandatory housing affordability zoning changes. Sometimes people refer to it as HALA, but I think it's important to understand that HALA that stands for the Housing Affordability and Livability Agenda. That report is actually made up of 65 different recommendations, of which the mandatory housing affordability strategy is one of those 65 recommendations. Some of the other recommendations that are part of the Housing Affordability and Livability Agenda were implemented in 2017, including the housing levy, including a housing bond. That was another, it was a HALA recommendation. Increased tenant protections, and the passage of what we refer to as the MHA framework legislation. It's what we're moving into now are the actual zoning changes and the fee property owner obligation regulations that will put it into place. The framework legislation kind of laid out what the broad policy objectives were, and we passed that last year. The framework legislation laid out, one, how all developers will contribute to new affordable housing in all developments, whether or not it's residential or commercial, in exchange for additional zoning capacity by either building affordable homes on site or making a payment to a fund the city uses for affordable housing throughout the city. We currently have that fund because we use it for our incentive zoning program, which is the voluntary version of MHA, which MHA is now going to be mandatory, whereas the voluntary proposal was for property owners only in certain areas of the city that wanted to take advantage of existing height. If they chose to, they would then have to contribute into this fund. Right? What we're going to be doing is whether or not property owners choose to take advantage of all of the height capacity or not, they're going to have to pay into the fund or provide housing. We know that the proposal for MHA focuses changes both within urban villages as well as multifamily and commercial. throughout the city. The residential urban village here in Delridge is, of course, the Westwood Highland Park residential urban village. Unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to go into the level of detail on those changes that I'd like to, because I noticed on my way over here from the bus that my overworked staff printed out the existing zoning for Westwood, not the proposed zoning. But in general, the idea is for areas that you see that are yellow here, these are the single-family areas. They're talking about, look at you go. They're talking about turning that into something that's a little bit broader than single-family. It's called residential small lot. And then they're talking about a relatively small bump up in other parts of the urban village. For instance, Delridge property that's currently zoned neighborhood commercial 40 might see a bump to neighborhood commercial 55, or low-rise parcels might stay low-rise with expanded development opportunities within there. I've heard concerns that some people feel that the city's moving too fast on this. We are relatively early in the process. The city has begun to develop an environmental impact statement to measure the benefits and impacts of the current proposal. And there are numerous opportunities to influence that draft. For instance, there's the ability to provide feedback prior to the March, the mid to late March release of the draft EIS. Then after that draft EIS is released, people will have at least another 45 days to provide additional comment. That's the point at which, depending on the sufficiency of the draft EIS in identifying the issues raised in public comment, which the council has been tracking, we've had staff at all of the community meetings that are occurring, and we're making note of all of the issues that members of the public have been raising. We're going to check the draft EIS, see that those issues are raised, and if not, I might consider asking for additional opportunity for public comment. Then there's the final EIS, and that will further incorporate public comment. That will be scheduled to be released in the summer. Final legislative proposal will be coming to the City Council at the end of 2017. And the City Council isn't planning on beginning the legislative process, which is also a public process, until early 2018. So that means from under this current schedule, if there are no requests for additional time, there will be a six-month opportunity to comment on the final proposal before we begin to consider legislation in early 2018. Covers. I got my hand up all mixed up. What's this, I think? Yeah. There's a one-night count tomorrow night that I'll be participating in. It happens every year. It's the efforts of the city, together with literally hundreds of volunteers that span out across King County to count the people who are sleeping outside. We go out at 2 o'clock in the morning and we count until about 6 o'clock in the morning. This is an annual event that I participate in, and it really influences my passion to not just address issues related to homelessness, but really to focus on what I feel are true public safety challenges, risks, threats to people who are sleeping on our streets every night unsheltered. We have a whole other homeless population that's either in shelter or in transitional housing. I think the real priority for the city needs to be on getting people inside children sleeping outside. As far as sort of what's in front of us right now, lost track here. So we're in a state of emergency. We've been in a state of emergency now since 2015. Earlier this year, a consultant made a recommendation called Pathways Home. We are now officially in the gap to Pathways Home stage, and a couple of the actions that are that the mayor determined were necessary near term, while we are sort of gearing up to implement the recommendations of the consultants, relate specifically to addressing just what the challenges that I referenced, which is the outdoor homeless population. Last week, the mayor issued an executive order to open 3 additional tent encampments in the city. Each encampment will serve between 60 and 70 unsheltered residents. One of the locations is the current Myers Way encampment. Some constituents have contacted me with concerns. Gunner has been leading the community conversation around those concerns. Specifically, I've heard a lot about illegal dumping near the site and the surrounding greenbelt, the issues of people sleeping in the greenbelt, not on the sanctioned encampment site. And then people really want to make sure that they're, that there's some accountability for the over the city for making sure that we are communicating with the community, that we have a way of addressing impacts as they come up, and that we're, you know, we have an approach to addressing the needs of the people who are staying in families. We have legislation in the municipal code that specifies sort of what the expectations are for sanctioned encampments, and unfortunately, the mayor's order, as it was drafted, did not incorporate the expectations that we have in the city's ordinance for our normal process of sanctioning outdoor encampments. And so I made some requests to make changes to the emergency order to reflect those standards, specifically the establishment of a community advisory committee to facilitate resolution of complaints as they come up, development of an encampment operations plan, and making sure that there's that at the site there's access to bathrooms and potable water and removal of garbage no less frequently than weekly. These changes to the emergency order were accepted, and I'm going to doggedly follow their implementation and monitor how it goes moving forward. In addition, I'm also working with Seattle Public Utilities to support community requests for monitoring of the water quality at nearby Ham Creek, as well as the wetlands, both of which are impacted by the unauthorized camping in other sections of the Greenbelt. Finally, the mayor, as part of the Bridging the Gap to Pathways, had pulled off Office of Civil Rights inspectors from the monitoring of the removal of encampments. The city has a process for calling in complaints around unsanctioned camping, and that process includes prioritizing which encampments need removing according to a number of criteria, the first of which, of course, are life and safety impacts. Because of concerns associated with how those encampment removals were being accomplished, the mayor, for a time, had Office of Civil Rights inspectors monitoring that work. The mayor announced about a month and a half ago that he was no longer going to have them doing that monitoring. I requested that they stay in that role, at least through the implementation of a new set of protocols that we've recently been briefed on that aren't yet public, but that are going to be going public very soon. There's going to be a public comment period. This is the alternative to the legislation that the council was considering last year to regulate how encampment removals are done. So instead, the mayor has these new revised protocols that I think does, I even though I was sort of helping move the legislative approach along, I never thought that the management of city property should be done legislatively. I felt like it's under the purview of the executive, and I'm much more comfortable with it being done in a way that's both guided by the executive as well as these new protocols. This other items related to homelessness includes close monitoring of the Pathways Home Implementation Plan. In particular, there's a lot of different recommendations, but in particular, we have a commitment to bring at least 500 unsheltered families indoor by the end of the year, and to increase the options to serve unsheltered residents with low barrier 24/7 shelter, making sure that the shelter that we're funding is actually meeting the needs of the people who need the shelter, whether or not that's a place where people can stay with their partner, with their pet, their companion animal, people who have needs associated with their drug and alcohol addiction to be to not require sobriety in order to access shelter, and then a whole other set of policies moving forward that will increase not just the availability of shelter, but the likelihood of people accessing it. And I think that's pretty much it for me. How long did it go?
I think that's great. You're actually just right on time. Look at that. Because we want to make sure, I know I have a lot of questions, I'm sure many in the audience. I'm going to help facilitate the Q&A. I'm actually going to start with Mary Ann from South Delridge with her first set of questions, and then we'll open it up to the rest of the group, and I'm going to do sweeps across the room, so I'm going to also kind of keep track of people so that you don't have to keep your hand up the whole time as much as possible.
This deals with the encampment, and I went to the meeting on Monday, and it said that they do not have an operator yet for Myers Way. So we're curious how we're going to deal with no operator, the problems and disputes that come up in the camp. They were describing that in another operating situation. Does that also go with the community advisory committee if there's issues between the encampment and the residents? Because I know people are having a problem in Top Hat, and we went through on the drive-through, and there's some real issues, and we want to make sure that we are representing our communities of people who are living there first and foremost.
That's
and then we're trying to help you solve an issue. Right?
Yeah, that's definitely. The mechanism that I see as being useful to addressing those accountability issues. And so it's intended to help resolve those disputes or those challenges or problems. I mean, there may be problems that we have to troubleshoot around. And so the expectation would be that it would be a body that would include residents, both sheltered and unsheltered residents, and a roundtable approach that also the city would monitor to make sure that it's action-oriented.
Well, and what happened in Monday's meeting was that there were different city organizations, and whether it was the police or the SPU, and they were saying, well, we're still trying to figure this all out. And I think for us as a community, we'd like to have some concrete policies, procedures that we know that you are going to implement,
right,
and then get these neighbors out of these homes, out of these encampments, and into permanent shelter. So how soon can we see that?
this is something that the executive is leading, and I can push. And that's my role, is to try and be as we will. I think the first step was the step we took last week, which is to create the expectations, that the entire council has expressed. And so that's not just for this community roundtable accountability, but also for an actual operations plan. And this is going to be an operations plan that is going to be shared. And if there are...
Before it starts?
It's supposed to start in March, right?
So when is that getting at?
Before it starts.
Okay, I'm going to go to the gentleman in the lovely purple shirt, whose name I've already forgotten, and then I'll come back to Amanda.
Hi, Phil. My name is Phil. We moved down, and we live near West Crescent Park, and when I look out a window toward the valley, I guess, all I see is smoke and smog coming up, and we do see smog on the street. I don't know how to address it, or who to talk to, or how to deal with a complaint about the significant number of amount of smog in our neighborhood. Mm-hmm. Do you have any ideas?
Puget Sound Air Quality Control is probably who I'd recommend that you reach out to. Puget Sound Air Quality Control. They're a statewide agency. I'm sorry, they're not statewide. They're Puget Sound. It's not a city entity. But they do have some regulatory authority. They do testing, air quality testing. They can send monitor out. And if they are able to create a nexus between the pollution and the creation of the pollution, they can actually cite the entity, it's a business, whether or not it's a business or the poor.
We see those big smokestacks. There's a lot of pollution coming out of them. Do you know who those smokestacks belong to? As you go down the hill from Highland, from West Crest Park, as you go down the hill, you'll see these big smokestacks that are just blaring out smoke.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
I think that's steam from making sheetrock.
That's steam?
Yeah.
It's not...
It's just a fact.
It's not smog.
No.
Okay.
The worst polluter has already been shut down at the fire where they used to make concrete, but they don't make it here in the state.
Thank you.
Can't make it here in the bush.
Thank you. I'm going to go to Amanda and then the woman in the green at the back.
Thanks for being here. Really appreciate it. I am going to do a broad thing for Westwood. Back at the end of July, there was a Find a Fix It walk that the mayor came and you were there. And we have seen very little action from that. And all of the projects that we have been working on for the past 4 years are kind of tied up into where the mayor walked and brought everybody in. We haven't had any feedback on that. So we're having a little bit of a difficulty in communicating with different agencies and people getting back to us and putting things off. So I am hoping that you might be able to start just pushing people just a little bit, especially on projects running the blog itself, talking about Longfellow Creek and talking about the North Delridge and all the projects that are going on with the wetlands. That all ties into the headwaters of the Longfellow Creek. So I'm kind of hoping that we can get a little bit more push on pedestrian safety around Westwood Village. There's literally nothing going on there. They put flashing beacons on 35th at Kenyon, but they haven't put a flashing beacon at Westwood Village, which I think is absolutely ridiculous. There hasn't been any movement on lighting, again, at the bus stop. We were supposed to see that starting in the first quarter this year. Actually, we were supposed to see it 18 months ago. But they keep being pushed back. So I'm asking you as a community member to just kind of start pushing some of those buttons because we feel like we're in a holding pattern because we don't know what to do at this point. We've got all these pots boiling or simmering, but we're not sure where to push. So we appreciate
it. So are you in your efforts to advocate for the completion of these projects that there were commitments?
Yeah.
On the walk. Are you dealing with central person for all of the things, or are you dealing department by department for
yes
city no. light on the lighting stuff and SDOT?
Yeah, the lighting, I was dealing with someone from Metro. I'm talking to Paul Roybal from Metro.
That's unfortunate. Wouldn't it be nice if there was a single person for the follow-up on all of the money fixing items?
Yes.
So I'm advocating for that because especially in a situation where we have lost the support of the city as a community group, it'd be really important to make sure that there is some follow-up, especially on things that were promised, you know, back at the end of July.
Absolutely.
Outside of the department of neighborhood scopes.
I'm more than happy to follow up on, especially considering that I was there myself.
Right.
That
we're
so. Appreciate
that.
Thanks.
Can
I just follow up to that? One moment, please. We're going to move to this woman in the green, and then Kay, and then I'll come to you back.
Well, I was following up to her, so.
Well, I'm going to keep going with our Q&A.
As you are probably aware, you know, we lost that really nice new bathroom in the park to arson like almost 2 years ago now. And it's still sitting there just derelict with a couple of porta potties out in front of it. I'm sure the city's self-insured. But where are we gonna get that back? Lots and lots of people use that bathroom. A lot of people, homeless people from the Greenbelt, truck drivers, school bus drivers, everybody, there's a lot of people in that park in Riverview I'm talking about.
Yep.
Yeah, so I just want that project to get taken care of. Do you know what's going on? I have a follow-up question.
Did I?
I've never asked you about that.
No? Okay. I felt like I did get some commitments from the city on that a while ago.
Yeah, I kind of heard something might happen, but it sure isn't happening. I'm sure it's self-assured. We have to build it out. I heard Parks and Rec has to pay for it. But if there's something in process that we have to do, it'd be great to know what it is.
Yep.
And also, I'd like to just support the $200,000 going to the roundabout. Mm-hmm. I met a city inspector here today, and while he was waiting for me, he was experiencing the traffic going by, and he said, oh, gee, you sure have a lot of traffic going by here. What a great business opportunity. And I just feel like the city could gain a lot of credibility in regards to this density proposal if we started addressing the infrastructure right now, instead of waiting until later. I mean, I have 10 new units going in a two-block area, so that's 20 new cars right here, and I'm sure the rest of Delridge and Westwood is feeling that same growth, and we're going to be encouraging more growth, and yet people back up from the roundabout all the way down to Holden in the morning, from 16, all the way down the hill in the evening now. It's completely unsafe to walk through your street, my street. So could we put some safe route to school money into it, or what can we do? We need to address that. This is not something that can be put off.
Definitely follow my efforts through the supplemental process. It begins probably March or April, stay engaged and contact with the council members.
$1.2 million is not that much for a traffic project. I know it's a lot of money, but we're putting money into projects. When I look around at the budgets that got, or the things that got funded through the street fund last year, it was like, oh yeah, great.
Yeah, I mean, my MO when it comes to being a council member is to keep things moving, right? I'm not gonna worry about the fact that we don't have the full $1.2 million, but what can we do now with what we have to take a step in the direction? And I think funding the design work is the way to go. So.
We have the West Seattle, we have the main gas line running into West Seattle right there. Remember that guy hit it with the car? Almost blew up all his apartments. You know, so, sorry.
No, it's dangerous.
I'll stop.
I'm glad that you're passionate about it.
Wow. Really. There's a couple other places that need SDOT money also.
Absolutely.
Because so I'm going to move to Beth to just keep our flow going, and I've got a couple people in
Just wanted to follow up with the idea of a central location, a central person, or a central department to deal with these find and fix it issues. Is there any possibility of that happening? Or how would one try to advocate for something like that? So, because whenever you're dealing with anything infrastructure-wise, whether you're going to find and fix it or not, you are dealing with several departments, and really what they say most of the time is, oh, well, that's their job, you know, and you're just getting basically passed around constantly.
Right. I think in the short term, you should think of me as the sort of person who's acting as sort of the ombudsman for all of the issues. I can't give you the answers, but
okay.
I can
great
find out who has them, and I'm happy to play that role of sort of herding the cats from all the other
and getting the brothers to actually communicate with each other.
I'm going to take the gentleman in the gray in the back.
Addressing the issue about the roundabout, it's gotten so bad now that I don't know. I live on 13th between Canyon and Elm Grove, and in the morning now, 13th and 12th are now sidetracked off of Holden. They'll come up 12th and 13th, go to Canyon and Elm Grove, and turn onto that. And in the evening, and I've contacted the Seattle Police Department about this, but up by Highland Park Elementary and the park there, that street is rather wide. I can't remember the name of it. I think it's someone help me. People are coming off of 9th Avenue there in the evening at 25, 30, 35 miles an hour all the way to the roundabout. My concern is the children in and out of that park and to and from school and coming home from school in the morning. I would hope that we do not have to wait till a disaster happens, till we get some enforcement on that street. Streets now are supposed to be 15 miles an hour, if I'm not correct, on side streets. There is nobody.
20.
Okay, there is nobody. There's nobody going 20 miles an hour on that side street between 3 and 5 in the afternoon. I walk my dog there every day, and I've seen, in the last 2 months, I've seen two near misses with children. Let's not wait till we lose.
Yeah, I mean, the challenge I've had on the side streets issue is that SPD, prioritizes its speed enforcement efforts on the arterials. And I think it would be kind of difficult to get emphasis enforcement on a neighborhood side street, but one
I think
correct
you're
me
right.
If I'm wrong.
I think you're correct. And keep in mind, the emphasis is generally going to be the traffic sections that will be dragged all over the place. And by current policy to allow 911 responders available for priority one and priority two calls, a lot of the traffic officers are now investigating the collisions that are occurring all over the city. So, you've got a set number of officers dedicated to traffic. Again, the patrol officers are also writing tickets. But the primary response has generally been the traffic section, and they've had to absorb the investigation of collisions, for example.
So what do you suggest somebody do when there's a real speeding problem in an area where there's a lot of kids,
it's single lanes, but that particular road is like a two-lane without a divider down the middle of it. And people seem to think it's an arterial.
The city has a...
So Terry actually...
Terry can answer this question, because Terry and I spent a lot of time talking about this.
I'm still the neighborhood district coordinator, at least for a little while. So what I would suggest, sir, when you could get in contact with me, but you certainly could go through the process with the SDOT Traffic Calming Division and see if you can't, if you can really document using a radar gun that you can check out, do a speed study on your own. If you can document that you have the volumes and you indeed have the speeds that are above the 85th percentile, then they will consider installing a traffic calming measure. So maybe some speed humps or something else. But contact me and I can walk you through the process and put you in touch with the person. But you got to be able to prove it. And a lot of times when we think they're speeders, they're not.
I can guarantee you won't have any
problems. And HPAC will work with you on that because we were able to get that for 12th and it's coming this summer. So I'm happy to work with you. We're going to move to Michael.
Hey, thank you for being here. You mentioned during your remarks about the North Delridge Neighborhood Action Plan update, which as someone who was well, I guess still is part of that process. I concur that, like, kudos to the city on demographic outreach and, you know, multilingual outreach and doing a pretty good job spreading around our district. At the same time, it really is, you know, even though it covers some wider aspects, it really is the North Delridge Action Plan update, which it has more to do with just how the plans originally developed back in 99 and 2000. And there's some interest in folks on wanting to sort of broaden that and make sure that we really include what's going on in Highland Park, what's going on in High Point, what's going on in South Delridge, and seeing if we can't broaden that a little bit. On the other hand, we really just saw the 2035 plan update that the council, you know, adopted, like, literally removes references to neighborhoods that were in the previous comp plan. And it's clear that DON is moving somewhat away from, our Department of Neighborhoods, is moving away from some of their focus on neighborhoods. Do you have ideas for what we can do to access some resources to help us sort of continue those conversations and discussions and broaden it across the whole district?
I've asked, and OPCD insists that it's removal of the word neighborhood from neighborhood planning and calling it community planning is not to suggest that they will not still do planning within a geographic area, but that they felt that the word neighborhood was not inclusive enough of the people that they want to participate in planning processes in neighborhoods. So we are going to be getting from OPCD, Office of Planning and Community Development, some more detail on what their process is for how to prioritize requests for, I'm just going to call it neighborhood planning. A lot of communities want to do planning. Communities that haven't planned before want to do planning. Neighborhoods that have already done their plan, but it needs an update, want updates. So the city needs a way of prioritizing those requests because they're, as you know, anybody who's ever participated, they're really intensive processes. So we're going to learn more about how they intend to do that, and I hope to influence some of the decision making about how. You prioritize those requests and with a strong focus on issues related to equity.
Thank you.
Kim?
Michael summed it up for me. That was exactly the same of my question of how we can get South Delridge on the docket to get funding for an updated neighborhood plan, considering that Westwood Highland Park has such a huge upzone proposal in it, that it's really badly needed. So you've answered the question sufficiently about it's kind of a wait and see as far as next steps, but any opportunity for some of the community to get tasked to help you to get that funding would be great. Thank you.
Earl?
I have just one little thing going back to Amanda that we had with the find and fix it.
Yep.
Also, because you were at the conversation that we were having about 26th Avenue and SDOT repairing the streets there. That's, and I just want to bring that up because that's kind of gotten fallen by the wayside.
All right.
And that was part of a major plan that they wanted to take care of.
Right. You know, I haven't checked recently on what the update is on the city's lawsuit against Puget Sound Energy. The city's actually suing Puget Sound Energy for their failure to do the repairs that they're required to do that will help with some of the vibrations. They did some work and it wasn't very good work. And it's sort of under because of our contractual obligation with them. And they're dragging their feet on whether or not they're going to fulfill those obligations, and the city law department has filed a lawsuit against PSE. So I'll find out. I think that might be part of what's holding it up, is because, again, it's their responsibility, and if we did it, then that's going to affect our ability to prevail in court.
And then Matt?
Hey, Lisa. Going back to the siting of encampments, one of the things that I've been in discussion with some community folks for a while has been the idea that as we're siting encampments, there are certain locations in the city that are going to see repeated sightings of encampments. We're one of them. Likewise, there are parts of the city that are never going to see the sighting. The thing about that is that when we sign an encampment, there's two things that are going on. We're increasing the burden in that community, both on the resources that are already being drawn from a city perspective, and on the individuals that live within the community itself. The city is making the people in that community, willing or unwilling, partners in the endeavor. Here's the concern, that as we sign these encampments, we're not directing funds into the community, additional funds, that we're not offsetting the additional burden on the infrastructure that's within that community, on the existing issues that are already within that community that have now been added to. And one of the things that I want to make sure is absolutely clear here, I believe that Delridge, specifically in Seattle, has really just comported itself in an exemplary fashion. We have been, in many cases, willing partners, and we've been willing to roll up our sleeves and help the city get this work done, but that's been very difficult for this community, as this community faces a lot of challenges already. The suggestion that I have, and that I would love if you would pursue, is to seek a source of funding for when an encampment is sited, there's an additional amount of funds that the city invests into itself in the community that encampment is sited. Not necessarily funds directed at the encampments themselves, funds directed at the infrastructure in that area. So we could use some more cops. We could use better buses. You mentioned the food desert. We could use better movement on that. We've got a long list of things that would really benefit from additional infrastructure investment by the city into the city in this area. Because as you're making us partners, our ability to partner with you to accomplish this is going to be greatly enhanced by the effort and the investment that you put into us.
I agree with that. I understand that you're talking sort of investment in kind of infrastructure that is to the benefit of everybody in the surrounding community. And so this may not be exactly what you're thinking about, but we did add funding this year, and it was funding that I championed for additional SPU pickups. And so SPU is doing something that they've never done before, and they're going to pick up garbage on a regular basis at both sanctioned and unsanctioned encampments, with the focus being reducing the temperature around this really unfortunate crisis by addressing the public health issues associated with garbage. I think, we've done that with SPU. I agree we need to do that. We need to figure out a way to do that around bus service.
I think that's your mom. She wants you to get home.
Yeah, it is really, really important. And I think that's one of the things that I want to talk to, as it relates to bus services in particular. I want to talk to colleagues in the council who also have encampments in their district to figure out if we can, of the encampments, if there are in other districts, if there are others that suffer from infrequent bus service, like we do here. some sort of an innovative solution to address that. So that's high on my radar. Some good news about bus service that I received. You know, one of the 131, for those of you who take it, is a laugh. Yes. I just learned it's still a ways away. You know, I was trying to respond to community requests to reroute it back through White Center, like it once did. You're saying no. We have made commitments to all the development that's happening in Greenbridge and Burien, frankly. And so they're unwilling to reroute it, but the good news is that not until September, so it's a ways away, we're going to get another bus, not added to our route, which is going to reduce the peak wait times to 15 minutes.
What you need to do is cut the 26 and the 131 in half. That's all you have to do.
That's not a bad idea.
So I'm going to
like the 120.
But going from 30-minute wait at peak time to 15-minute wait.
Be much better.
I'll say.
So we are going to close. I'm going to take moderator's privilege with my last two questions. That's right. That's all. So first, I want to just piggyback off of Matt. Highland Park Action Committee sent a pretty extensively long letter to the Director of Homelessness. Myself and several other committee members have spent an enormous amount of our volunteer time with George, driving him around and giving him a tour of our neighborhood and our situations. And we have asked for neighborhood protocols that are related to the neighborhood and not necessarily the encampment itself.
Okay.
There is a lot of protocols around encampments. Mm-hmm. There are not protocols when it comes to being in the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And as this will be our third go-around with sanctioned or quasi-sanctioned encampments, we feel like we deserve to have neighborhood protocols. Mm-hmm. And you did use some of ours but we would like to see all of those implemented.
Yeah.
Because as Matt had talked about, and as I have provided information and research around, we are a neighborhood in a stressful environment already. We, as you know, have the highest percentage of people who don't speak English in this neighborhood. We have a Highland Park Elementary, which has 85% of our students who are on free and reduced lunch. And I feel like that in order for us to continue to partner with the city and to work with our neighbors who do not have a voice in Top Hat and Highline and White Center, that we need to have some of these protocols in place. And so our request from Highland Park Action Committee is that we will push forward our requests around that, and that myself and some other members will work with you on that neighborhood protocols.
I would like to work with you on that. I think those are, expectation setting and accountability are completely reasonable demands of the city, so thank you.
Thank you. And then my last question has to do with Highland Parkway and Southwest Holden, which I know you've addressed, but we, as you know, as you live here, we are going on 70 years requesting something to be done with that intersection. And, yes, 70 years. And we would like to know.
Is there like a specific date associated with that?
I couldn't find it.
Michelle can send it to you.
I can think it's actually 75 or 76. And then when I went to the city clerk's office, we weren't able to find anything because it wasn't approved by the city.
It might be fun to do a little event associated with that.
Yeah, it's more than we already passed the city.
Yeah, so we, what we would like to know is who do we need to put pressure on besides me?
Yeah.
Because at this point in my history, I'm a direct action activist, and I've already set up signs saying, tired of being in traffic, call so and so. Who should we have people call?
That's a really good idea.
Mayor is up for re-election.
Is it the state?
I think contacting council members. as we bring forward a budget proposal associated in March or April, associated with the quarterly adjustment. I mean, and I, you know, I would really focus on the committee that is going to be hearing the adjustment first, which
is that?
It's affordable housing, finance, and something else.
Okay.
But I'm on it. Councilmember Burgess chairs it, and yeah, I think that would be a great.
I'm on it. Carrie, give me some signs. and I will say, because the other day when I was driving up the hill, there were two young kids that were taking their life into their hands trying to cross the street to get to the stop. And so
every day
there are, it is increasingly, as you know, getting worse. 12th Avenue Southwest is getting a traffic circle this summer. We did advocate for speed bumps on all three of the streets. We didn't get them, but we'll work with our community members to continue to get more traffic circles, because 12th Avenue Southwest is the only one that goes from here to Southwest Roxbury, and we don't have traffic circles through the whole street, which is, I mean, the fact there's no stop signs is just weird.
Yeah.
And I was ready to buy some of my own. So,
but let's work together closely on that, though, because I think once I know more about the process, I think it'll just be important as far as timing and to sort of check my understanding that that would be the best approach. So if there may, we might want to do some early work with the director, Kubli, depending on what kind of information I get back from them about my request to help me scope out the cost of the design.
Great.
So,
thank you.
Yeah.
Please give